Thank you. The search of a deeper understanding of our universe at the Large Hadron Collider, the world's largest particle accelerator. So in the next 3/4 of an hour, roughly, I try to guide you a little bit through the excitement of our findings, through the also a little bit through the engineering, and also I want to tell you some of the questions which you should ask yourself essentially every day. Namely, why, what has nature done in order so that we can be here? Because some of the questions we are studying there should give the answers to why we can exist. So today's scientific challenge, or one of the challenges, is to understand the very first moments of our universe after the Big Bang. It started with a very hot, tiny spot on the left-hand side here. Is there a pointer? No, I don't think so. On the left-hand side, and then the universe expanded over roughly 13.8 billion years to today's size of 10 to the 28 centimeters. Now, I don't know if anybody can imagine what 10 to the 28 is. And now I bring my joke, despite the fact that my wife told me, leave it off. But she's not here today. So maybe I can help you to imagine the 10 to the 28. If you replace the centimeters by dollars, you have roughly the square of the American deficit. It didn't help me very much concerning the universe. It only helped me that the deficit must be pretty large. Okay, so, but how can we look into the history of the universe? Well, I have it here again on the ruler. From the Big Bang on the left top to today, 10 to the 28 is 10 to the 28 of today's size. On the left top at the Big Bang, as difficult as it is to imagine the large scales, it is also very difficult to imagine the small scales. What's the difference between 10 to the minus 20 and 10 to the minus 24? Imagine, I can't imagine it. But for the universe, it was a huge difference. Because the development has really characterized the universe in the very first moments at the very small scales. So, looking into the history of the universe, we can do it at the large scales. We can look into the history with space-based telescopes, AMS or Hubble, for example, and the ground-based telescopes like Very Large Telescope and ALMA. And ALMA was just inaugurated a few weeks ago. And AMS is the only big scientific instrument on the space station, and we at CERN have the control center for this experiment, so every day signals go up from CERN to this experiment, and every day we receive the data, or the experimenters receive the data there. So we have a tiny toe also in space. Most of our stuff is underground, but one toe we also have in space. But when you look with these instruments, you come only as close as roughly 300,000 years to the Big Bang. You cannot come closer, because the universe was in the first 300,000 years so hot still, at least for photons. With neutrinos it's different, I know. With neutrinos you get to 1 second, okay? But with these telescopes, you get only to 300,000 years, because the universe was so hot that no information could come out at that time. So you get as close as 300,000 years, which is a lot compared to 13.8 billion years. So you can do it differently. You can look on the small scales. And looking on the small scales, you need a super microscope. And the Large Hadron Collider, as a big accelerator, is nothing else than a super microscope. Looking into the small dimensions, but by looking into the small dimensions, it comes as close as a millionth of a millionth of a second to the Big Bang. A millionth of a millionth of a second. You will agree it's quite close. However, still in this one millionth of a millionth of a second, a lot has happened in the development of the universe. So this is why we have to measure very accurately in order to be able to extrapolate towards the Big Bang. So for the non-scientists, what is the role of accelerators? Well, High energy means you can better resolve the inner structure of matter. And don't worry, I have altogether only 3 formulas in the whole talk. So with higher energy, you get a smaller wavelength, as you see in this formula. The smaller wavelength means higher resolution power. So you can look at smaller objects. So the higher the energy, the better your resolving power. But you can also produce new particles. The higher the energy, the higher mass particles you can produce. So you have 2 advantages, better resolving power and production of higher mass particles. And the 3rd advantage is you can repeat the experiment all the time, every day, every year, etc. And that means you get high statistics, a high number of events, you can do precision measurements. So resolving power, high mass particles, and precision measurements. How do we get to this high energy? Well, the acceleration happens through the electric voltage. You see here a battery of 1 volt, for example, from the plus pole and the minus pole. The proton, the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, gets accelerated from the plus to the minus pole. It has a charge E, 1 E, going to 1 volt. So it has an energy of 1 E volt. That's the measure we do. That's the measurement quantity we have. In order to run to produce the energy at the LHC, which has 7 TeV on 7 TeV, 1 TeV is 1,000 GeV, is a 1 with 12 zeros electron volt. So in order to reach the LHC energy, you need 2 times 7,000 billion batteries or 14 batteries per star in the Andromeda galaxy. We do it slightly differently. But that gives you a feeling of what you would need in order to produce this energy. Okay, so, but what is the beauty of studying the history of the universe on the large scales and on the small scales? You get a fantastic symbiosis between the small scales, the particle physics, the large scales, astrophysics, and cosmology. And these are intriguing questions which are very nice in order to intrigue young people to go into physics, for example. Now, what have we learned over the past 102 years? And I have chosen here the young Rutherford. And I think it's now 102 years, if I'm not mistaken, that he found out, essentially, that you are all empty, by the way, okay? Because the atoms consist out of the nuclei and the electrons. The nuclei, in turn, consists out of protons and neutrons. And these, in turn, consist out of the quarks and the gluons. Now let's see what we have learned about that microcosm. But these are the matter particles. Well, we have a family of matter particles up, down. These are the 2 quarks, which you just saw, which form the proton, essentially, and the electron, and its neutrino, the electron neutrino. And the dots here should indicate the relative mass of the particles. So the smallest, very small mass is for the electron neutrino. And actually, this is all which I need for you. Because we all consist out of these 2 quarks and the electron. All of you. Well, me included, of course. Everything of the visible matter here consists only out of these 3 particles, of the matter particles. But nature has decided one family is not enough. I produce a 2nd family. Again, with 2 quarks and 2 leptons, so charm and strange, and then the muon. And they all behave very, very, very similar to the 1st family. The only difference is the relative mass. So the 2nd family is much more massive than the 1st family. Well, there's still some space. So nature has decided 2 are not enough. I have a 3rd one. Again, 2 quarks and 2 leptons, top and bottom, and the tau lepton and the tau neutrino. And now you can imagine what happens. That's the mass. So the top quark here is the heaviest known elementary particle. It's as heavy as a gold atom, but it's essentially point-like. So it's a point-like particle as heavy as a gold atom. We know that there are 3 families. We have measured that at lab. Dave Charlton was at that time a bit younger, as was I. We remember very well this nice measurement. So we know there are 3 families, but we don't know why there are 3 families. Why are there not more families? So that's an unsolved question. plus, of course, the corresponding antiparticles. All these particles have their antiparticles. And that's also an interesting fact, because particles and antiparticles are always produced in pairs. So from energy, you make matter or mass. Energy to mass, you always produce particle and antiparticle. And of course, when they meet, they can also annihilate each other. So you make out of mass, you make energy. So if two particles, particle and antiparticle, are meeting, then they annihilate. At the Big Bang, matter and antimatter were produced in equal quantities. So that's the first question. We should not be here, because all matter and antimatter should have annihilated. However, nature has introduced a small asymmetry in the behavior, in the properties of matter and antimatter, so that at the end there's one part in 10 billion more matter than antimatter. And this one part in 10 billion is sitting here. So please remember, you are only a small distortion of the big universe, okay? And I come back to that question when I talk shortly about LHCb. Okay, and there's no sign of antimatter in the universe, so it's again another mystery. Where is all the antimatter gone and why? And that brings me to the standard model of particle physics. You see again the three families of quarks and leptons. Now these three families, and the quarks and the leptons, they have to interact with each other. They have to exchange information. What should we do? How should we behave, etc. For this you need the force particles. There is really no pointer? Okay. So the matter particles are on the left and the force particles are on the right. And just as a reminder again, these three particles are all we need for us. Okay? Now, the interaction between all these particles goes through these different forces. Now, take the photon. The photon is the messenger of the electromagnetic force, which is, for example, also needed in order to keep the atom stable. The gluons are the messengers of the strong force, which, for example, keeps the nuclei together. And the Z and W are the messengers of the weak force, which are, for example, responsible for the process is happening in the sun. So we have these force particles and we have the matter particles. But until July last year, we had one big question open. We had tested this standard model with very high precision, experimentally validated up to something like 100 GeV, so that's a factor of 10 below, or more than 10 below the energy of the LHC. However, one crucial question was still left open. How do the elementary particles acquire mass? This was not known until then. And actually, if you look here again on these 4 times 3 matter particles and these 4 force particles, this is the periodic system of the microcosm. And I hope you all agree, particle physics is much easier than chemistry. Yeah? Okay. I hope there are not too many chemists in here, but okay. So, how do elementary particles... Oh, that would be great. Yeah, thank you. Okay, that's a bit easier. No, that's okay. It's okay. I have only 2 hands. That's good, thank you. Okay. So, we had one key element in the standard model missing, and this is how the particles get mass, and that is where the Higgs boson comes in. The Higgs boson is the last missing cornerstone of the standard model, and it's needed in order to understand how particles elementary particles acquire their mass. And if you leave out in this model here the last cornerstone, it breaks down. Yeah? So it's of utmost importance to understand the microcosm and the early universe. So, what is a possible solution? Well, you can define mass also through inertia. So mass is a property of particles with an energy E to move with a velocity normalized to the velocity of light, c, according to this formula. That means at the same energy, if the higher the mass, the lower the velocity. Or with mass equals zero, you have velocity equals to light velocity. That means the higher the mass, the lower the velocity at the same energy. So what can one do? One can introduce a scalar field. A scalar field is a field which has no directional preference all over the, everywhere in the universe, and the particles acquire their mass through the interaction with this field. And the self-interaction of the field is the Higgs particle. That sounds a bit abstract, but in principle it's very easy. So this is a universe where you would not exist. This is a universe where, for example, the photons, these are these white ones, the photons are flying with, well, you have imagined this velocity of light. And the red ones are, for example, the quarks. Yeah? They fly through here, or the electrons, or whatever. They fly through all with the velocity of light. No chance that you can form bound states. Yeah? So without, in this universe, no bound states could exist. We could not exist. So then you go to a universe where we can exist, that one, and you see these white spots. This is the background field, and you see the photons are flying through this background field untouched, so they continue flying with the velocity of light, whereas the red ones, quarks or electrons, for example, they interact with this background field, they acquire mass, and therefore they can form bound states. So in this universe, we can exist. In this universe, we cannot exist. But that means that this particle and the discovery later of this particle touches really all your existence. It is a basis of our existence. Yeah, this is it's great. It's just fun. Okay. So, well, finally we seem to understand why we can exist. Okay, so that is this part. But there are many, many key questions of particle physics open. For example, is there a unification of forces possible at the high energy at the Big Bang? The standard model does not do that. That's the development of the forces up to the high energy. You see, they cannot meet. However, if you introduce another model around the standard model, for example, the famous supersymmetry, then you suddenly can unite the forces at the high energy. We don't know in the standard model what happened to antimatter. The standard model doesn't say anything about space, number of space dimensions, number of time dimensions. No idea. All these questions are completely open. And finally, the small question, what is dark matter, what is dark energy? Small question, because the standard model just it doesn't even explain. It describes roughly 5% of the universe, the visible universe. 95% of the universe are dark. Dark matter is roughly 1/4 of it, and dark energy roughly 3/4. We don't know what dark matter is. We only know it clumps, it acts via gravity, and it acts like normal matter, but we don't know what it consists of. We have not the faintest clue what dark energy is. We assume it is responsible for the accelerated expansion of the universe. So what are the solutions? Well, is the standard model successful forever? I don't think it can be, because it leaves so many questions open. And this is an impressive slide, otherwise I would not show it. These are all Nobel Prize winners which are connected with the standard model, except for one, Peter Higgs. But you see how many Nobel Prizes were given for the development and tests of the standard model. So this is quite impressive. So what could be the solutions? Well, it could be the supersymmetry. It could be extra dimensions. It could be so-called technicolor, which is a new strong interaction, or something which our theory friends still have to think of. But there's at least, except for this one, there's one feature. For all the proposed solutions which we have up to now, new particles should appear at the TV scale or even below which is the territory of the LHC. Therefore, the LHC will allow us to address, maybe even to answer some of the key questions. Will we understand the primordial state of matter after the Big Bang before the nuclei, the nucleons, protons and neutrons could be formed, so roughly 10 to the minus 5 seconds after the Big Bang? Then I've changed the will be to have we. Have we found the Higgs particle? It is not responsible for giving mass, but so I forgot the inverted commas, but it is the messenger of the mechanism which gives mass to all particles. So you remember this picture here. Will we find the reason why antimatter and matter did not completely destroy each other? And this tiny question, what is the mysterious dark matter and what is dark energy? So these are tremendous questions which the LHC will at least address. And this is the Large Hadron Collider in the beautiful surroundings of Geneva, roughly 100 kilometers underground, 27 kilometers in circumference. It is, I don't know if the largest scientific instrument, but one of the largest scientific instruments ever built, 27 kilometer circumference. Much more than 10,000 people involved in design, construction, and now in exploitation. It collides protons to reproduce the conditions at the beginning of the universe, and in the full design, 40 million times a second. 40 million times a second we try to collide the protons. And this is how it's done. We have in these 27 kilometers two pipes, vacuum pipes, because if you have the protons in air, they will immediately interact with the air and they will disappear. So here you have a vacuum, two vacuum pipes, so you have protons going clockwise and protons in the other ring anti-clockwise. You bring them to the collision at the collision points, at the points where you have the experiments. But we do not have single protons. We have packets of protons, so this is one packet of protons, and in each packet we have around 100 billion protons. So in each of the packets we have 100 billion protons which are colliding every 50 nanoseconds because we were only running with 20 million times per second. So 2012 we did 8 TeV, that means 4 on 4 instead of 7 on 7, and we had only half the number of bunches and therefore a 20 megahertz crossing rate of these packets. So what happens then? You have these packets colliding, and each of the packets, there are, as I said, 100 billion protons, and therefore, if you squeeze these packets well enough, then many protons will collide within one packet collision, so then you have colliding protons. Colliding protons means you collide the quarks and gluons which are in the proton, and out of the collision of these quarks and gluons, you produce new particles, you produce a very high energy, or high energy density, and out of this you produce new particles, and then you measure with these experiments, which I show in a second, you measure the trajectories of the particles which you produce there, and then out of this you reproduce what happened at the collision. So that shows you the hardware. This is one of the magnets. We have roughly 1,300 of these magnets in the 27 kilometer circumference. The length is, if I'm not mistaken, 15, I always forget these numbers, around 15 meters or 18 meters. Then they are transported along the 27 kilometers to the part where they have to be installed. Then you bring them there, you have them there, then you align them here. You see the interior of the magnets here with the pipes where the protons are running in, with all the insulation, etc. And then you align it, and then you have to connect it. And these are high power connectors which have to carry roughly 14,000 amps. And we have 10,000 of these. And one of these was faulty in 2008, and that produced the problem which we were faced with in the year 2009. And we are now in a shutdown in order to refurbish all of these 10,000 connectors. That means we open now, this year and next year, the collider roughly every 20 meters in order to refurbish these connectors. And we do, in addition, of course, a lot of other things. But since we decided to run at a slightly lower energy, or roughly half the energy, for 3 years the collider was looking like this, and this is how a director general likes it, because then you can take data. Then you can run, and you can take data, and you can produce physics. The LHC is one of the coldest places in the universe, because we are running it at minus 271 Celsius, or 1.9 Kelvin above absolute zero, which means it's colder than outer space. Outer space is 2.7 Kelvin. Why are we running it at this low temperature? It's superfluid helium in order to minimize the ohmic losses and to have a maximization of the cooling. So we have certainly the largest refrigerator on Earth. At the same place, at the same time, it's one of the hottest places in the galaxy. Because a collision of two proton beams generates temperature much, much larger than those in the center of the Sun, and that brings you to the Big Bang. Now, if you collide a proton with a proton, if you take just the energy, it's like the energy of a mosquito in full fly hitting another mosquito in full fly. I don't think you believe me that you get close to the early universe with two mosquitoes hitting each other. But the proton has a diameter which is very, very small. So the energy density, that means the energy divided by the area, is extremely high because the area is so small. So it is the energy density which brings you so close to the early universe in a collision of two protons. Okay, so 2010, we started a new era in fundamental science. We explored a new energy frontier in proton-proton collisions and heavy ion collisions. And we have four large experiments and three small ones, so we have altogether seven experiments at the LHC. And Birmingham is involved in ATLAS, and actually since 1st of March, it has also the spokesman of the experiment, so which is an, well, it doesn't happen so often that you become a spokesman or a spokesperson of an experiment. I mean, after all, they have more than 3,000 members from 39 countries, I think. 38. Ah, okay. Fine. I wanted to boost you up a bit, but no, I have counted CERN as a country. Okay? Then we are at 39. Okay.
177 institutes.
177 institutes. Okay. Actually, bracket. 3,000 scientists. Let's say 10% of them are professors. Let's say 300 professors. Can you imagine 300 egos to get them together? Yeah? That all work in the same direction. It's not so easy, but it works. It works. And it's a sociological experiment too. Okay, it's really nice. Okay, so ATLAS, then you're in LHCb, and as the only group in the UK, physics group in the UK, you're also in ALES. Now, ATLAS and CMS are the two omnipurpose experiments. They are supposed to measure all interesting reactions, at least in proton-proton collisions. LHCb is in particular addressing the question of the slight difference in the properties of matter and antimatter in studying heavy quarks. So this is a dedicated experiment. And ALES is mainly there in order to do to analyze the heavy ion collisions. However, there is a lot of complementarity, but also synergy between the different experiments, so they control each other. And that's another message. One and only one experiment is not good, because you should never believe the result of only one group. You always have to have it cross-checked by an independent group. This is a message to the young and sometimes also to the older people. And this is ATLAS during its construction. It's one of the largest and most complex detectors. And it shows you the size here. That's during the construction. This is the size of an average physicist. Okay. I thought it is 25 or 26 times 26 times 40 cubic meters. And in the whole volume, you have now roughly 100 or 150 million sensors, electronic sensors. And they measure the trajectories of the particles which are produced at this collision on average with the accuracy of the diameter of the human hair in the whole volume. So they measure the particle traces to an extraordinary precision. But imagine, these are like digital cameras. Imagine new digital camera with 150 million sensors or pixels, making 40 million or 20 million pictures a second. It's a lot of data. So what are the basic processes at the LHC? Well, you have these two protons which are colliding. Now the protons consist out of quarks and gluons, as I indicated, so you never know which quark or gluon from this proton was hitting which quark and gluon of this proton. So you, for example, you could hit quarks and quarks, and again, two quarks could come out, and these two quarks would manifest themselves in a jet of visible particles. Now, two jets of particles have to go back to back for momentum conservation, and therefore, if you roll up the ATLAS experiment here, for example, you see two very nice jets of energy. So these are the two jets of energy, they correspond to these ones, and they are back to back in the transversal plane. So this is what you study at the very beginning when you switch on collider and experiments. But of course, we are interested in the new physics, or at least at a certain stage. So for example, if you have two gluons hitting each other, then you could be producing the Higgs particle, which then could, for example, decay into two Zs or two Ws, and that would manifest itself in a very clean signature here. This is a CMS experiment, and a clean signature of the decay of these two particles. So again, to show you how that would happen, so you have here the protons colliding. You see the three quarks inside with a Higgs field around it. And then you leave the Higgs field alone, and that's the Higgs particle then. So that's a production of the Higgs particle. What is the problem? The problem is that this happens very, very rarely. So this is the production rate of the various processes as a function of the center of mass energy. Here is a 7 TeV, and here's which we were running in the first 2 years. And this is a total rate of processes. And then all this is standard model here. And then here is the interesting physics. And the rate of new physics is much, much lower than the total rate. So more than 10 orders of magnitude difference between the two, which means you have to select one out of much more than 10 billion events in order to have at least one candidate if you have 100% efficiency. You never have 100% efficiency, so you have to select even more, even out of many more than 10 billion. So what does it mean? We need high statistics. That means we need a high collision rate, which means, in our words, high luminosity. And this shows you the total integrated number of collisions. And for those who are not familiar with inverse femtobarn, which is our quantity, the number 5 here means 500 trillion collisions, if I'm not miscalculated. 500 trillion collisions. And this is in green, the data collection in 2010, in red is 11, and in blue is 2012. And you see 2010 is multiplied by a factor of 100, otherwise you would just see it as a baseline. But we did already, or the experiments did already, fantastic physics with this small amount of data in the year 2010. Then we increased the data rate in 2011, and then we were shooting up in 2012. And the 4th of July, the result was given with this amount of data, so accumulated 600 trillion collisions in 2012. But they have now, in total, roughly 30 inverse femtobarn, which is 500 trillion times 6. Okay, much more. Okay, you can well imagine a lot of collisions. But in order, and this shows you now one of the candidate events, which could be a Higgs particle. What happens if you have the packets very densely, very well focused, hitting each other? Then you have several protons hitting each other inside one packet collision. So you have multiple proton-proton collisions within one bunch collision, which you see you have to resolve all these different collision points. And then you can look, what comes from one vertex, and here you have, for example, a candidate for the Higgs particle where you have two muons and two electrons, which would be a decay into two Zs, for example. And you see it here, it can all come from the same vertex. You can well see it here and here. So, key issue is that you can resolve all these collisions even if you have multiple collisions in a bunch collision. And the record, as far as I know, is 78 proton-proton collisions in one bunch collision. 78 resolved. Now you can do that only once you have a fantastic computing power. And roughly 20 years after the World Wide Web was born at CERN, the grid computing was developed. So this is computing power all over the world used in order to store and analyze the data. And you see, the LHC experiments produce more than 25 petabytes per year of data. What does this mean? Look on this one here. The annual LHC data output is 25 petabytes. This corresponds to 25,000 terabyte, which is 25,000 times the world annual book production. So you can well imagine that you need tremendous amount of storage and a tremendous amount of computing power in order to be able to calibrate and analyze these data, and that only happens once you have a global collaboration. So we have, in principle, 8 experiments at the LHC because the grid is the 8th experiment. And without the grid computing, the experiments would not have been able to do the analysis in such a nice way already for 2012. So what do you do with all these data? Well, this is a physics output, and this is the integrated number of collisions which you collect, okay? So, at one inverse femtobarn, you have 100 trillion collisions. And then you start with a small amount of data here. And then you take your journey through the standard model, because the first thing is you have to prove that you understand the standard model also at the high energy, that you don't have flaws in the model or that you don't have flaws in the experiment. So you start, for example, with these two jets which I just showed. With a small amount of collisions, you can do that. And then you start measuring the standard candles of particle physics. Astronomy has standard candles. We also have standard candles like the W, the Z, the top, etc. And then you go through the standard model, you measure, for example, top production, then WW production, ZZ production, etc. So you need more and more data in order to measure the processes which become rarer and rarer. And once you have done the journey through the standard model, you can claim new physics if you find something different. And that shows you from ATLAS, for the experts here, an amazing, a small part of their measurements, but an amazing accuracy. It's really amazing. Look on this one here. So these are 5 orders of magnitude difference in production cross-section, so in the production rate. And this is, for example, the production of the W, of the Z, of top of two tops, one top, WW, WZ, W top, ZZ. So 5 orders of magnitude. The line in yellow or green is the standard model, and the dots are the measurements of the experiment. And you see there's a difference here between the 7 TeV and the 8 TeV running because the cross-section changes for these productions here. For these ones, they haven't measured it. I think it's too good. The agreement is fantastic between the model and the data, and I must say it's overwhelming how well these experiments can measure these different standard candles. Or here, you nearly don't see on this plot here on the production of a special particle here over, again, 8 orders or whatever orders of magnitude. Fantastic agreement between the model, these are the lines, and the data, the dots. So one can say these experiments understand very well their detectors. They have done beautiful precision measurement of standard model processes. They have now about completed their journey through the standard model, and they have now started to take us into new territories. So the new territory are these main questions here. I will not address all of them, but let's just start with the first one, courtesy of Alice, because it's the only UK group here in Alice. So this is a measurement of direct photons in the collision of, not of proton-proton, but of lead ions. Now, a lead ion consists out of 82 protons and 126, if I'm not mistaken, 126 neutrons. So you have 82 protons and 126 neutrons colliding with 82 protons and 126 neutrons. And this produces this hot, dense matter shortly after the Big Bang. It produces a very hot temperature, very small, tiny fireball. And this fireball has a temperature of 304 MeV measured. Whoever cannot calculate it immediately, transfer it immediately into degrees, this corresponds to around 3.5 10 to the 12 Kelvin. So this is one of the hottest temperatures. No, it is the hottest temperature ever produced by mankind, as far as we know at least. So it shows you that you really produce a very hot, very dense, very small fireball, and you can then measure in that fireball how the particles which were existing in this fireball, how they reacted and which forces acted between them. Okay. But this one is, of course, now in everybody's mind, and it also touches this part, so I treat these two parts now together. And let's start with dark matter. Now, it's quite obvious that dark matter, nearly 25% of the universe matter and energy density, must have shaped also the visible universe much more than the visible universe itself, because that's only 5%. So astronomy and astrophysics will study that. However, we would like to understand what is dark matter consisting of. And in order to understand that, you have to produce it in the laboratory. And only particle accelerators can produce dark matter in the laboratory, and then we can try to understand exactly what it is. And the LHC may be the perfect machine to study dark matter. What is a candidate for dark matter? Well, a very good candidate still is supersymmetry. Supersymmetry demands for each particle a supersymmetric shadow particle, so to speak. So for each particle, a supersymmetric partner is produced of opposite statistics. So out of a matter particle, so to speak, you make a supersymmetric force particle, and out of a force particle, you make, so to speak, a supersymmetric matter particle. Now, you might argue, if the particle physicists don't know what to do, they double the number of particles, everything fits better, and that's it. Well, I think it's now 84, 85 years or so ago that Paul Dirac wrote a very nice small equation on the motion of particles in vacuum, of electrons, and he found two solutions, one positive, one negative, with the mass, for the mass, because it was a quadratic equation in the mass. So he postulated then antimatter, antiparticles, around 85 years ago. And since, so with one short equation, he doubled the number of particles. A few years, I think 3 years later, the positron was discovered in cosmic rays. And we have learned a tremendous amount from this antimatter studies. And since around 40 years, we are using antimatter in hospitals. Positron emission tomography uses the positron, the antiparticle, to the electron, and this is roughly since 40 years. So antimatter has nothing mysterious, has nothing to do with angels and demons. It is used in hospitals. I'm not saying that in 40 years we use supersymmetry in hospitals, but just to give you an example how long time it can take in order to use basic science results for the society. Now, supersymmetry has the nice feature that it allows to unify the forces at the high energies, and it provides a dark matter candidate because in many of the models of supersymmetry, the lightest supersymmetric particle should be stable. Now, supersymmetry is not a single theory. It's a plethora of different models. And you see here again, that is the normal standard model, and here is this, the supersymmetric partners. And you can produce supersymmetric particles at the LHC. They would then decay into normal particles in blue and lower mass supersymmetric ones, normal one, lower mass, etc., until you had the lowest mass supersymmetric particle, which has no partner to decay into, and therefore it stays stable. So you would see it as missing energy, missing momentum, and you could produce, therefore, it could be candidate particles for dark matter. Now, if the experiments would have found something, you would have heard it, would have read it in the newspaper already. They didn't find anything up to now. And the air is getting thin for some of the supersymmetric models, the ones which are very much constrained. For the more open supersymmetric models, there's a lot of phase space still open. So I would say the potential for discovery of SUSY particles is sizable in the coming years. And sometimes one is allowed to have a dream. And in 2015, we are restarting the machine. And we are going to higher energy. And we can produce higher mass particles. So why couldn't we find in 2015 supersymmetric particles? That's my dream. It's my last year of as a director general. It would be a very good gift, David, okay? No pressure, no pressure, don't worry. Okay, so LHC results should allow, together with dedicated dark matter searches, the first discoveries in the dark universe. However, still, roughly 3/4 of the universe is in some mysterious dark energy, which is evenly spread. And the challenge is really to get the first hints about the world of dark energy in the laboratory. And this is really difficult. However, now comes the Higgs, because the Higgs is different. All matter particles have a spin, spin 1/2. All force particles have a spin, spin 1. The Higgs particle are spin 0, they are scalars. So the Higgs is neither matter nor force. And this would be the very first fundamental scalar ever which we have in our hands to study. So we never had up to now a fundamental scalar to investigate. So this Higgs particle is great because the Higgs, its field is thought to fill the entire universe, as does the dark energy. So both are scalar fields. I'm not saying that both are the same, by no means. However, both are scalars. And the study of a scalar like the Higgs could maybe give some indication about another scalar, of behavior of scalars in general. So the fantastic thing, so this Higgs particle is not only needed in order to explain how fundamental particles get their mass, it could open a much wider door into the dark universe. So this, with this one single particle, we open a fantastic door. Now, how did they find it? Well, this is again the total cross-section, many, many orders of magnitude below, is the production of the Higgs boson. So this is already difficult because you produce it very rarely. But it can also decay very, very differently, because giving mass to all the fundamental particles means it has to talk to each of the particles. That means it can decay, it can interact with all the different particles. So you have a plethora, you have a low production and a plethora of different ways of seeing it in the experiment. Sometimes now we are getting into springtime, but during winter, I usually use the comparison that the Higgs boson, for example, you can imagine is a special kind of a snowflake. And you have to identify this special kind of snowflake in a big snowstorm with a slight problem that the background is a snowfield, which means you have to have very sophisticated means and a lot of statistics. And this shows you how you find it. So in black, The black histograms are the standard model processes in different modes of the decays of the Higgs. So each time the black histogram is a snow field or the snow storm, and in red is a special snowflake. So you see here the special snowflake could be identified. Here it's essentially impossible. Here it is also essentially impossible because it's 50 times the production of the Higgs. So you have to be able to combine many, many of these different searches and to find out if all of them point towards the same mass of the special snowflake to the same Higgs boson mass. And let's now concentrate on the Higgs to gamma gamma. And you see, people with good eye can see this is the signal of the special snowflake. So this is a snowstorm in the snowfield, and this is a special snowflake. And that would look like this. So that was a production of the Higgs. You remember that? And that's the decay. Zack. Here you see the two photons. So from time to time, the Higgs can decay into two photons. And this is how it would look like in one of the detectors. That's CMS, on purpose, of course. And you see, these are two energetic clusters. These are the two photons which are coming from this collision point. All the other particles are background in this case. So these are the two particles which could be coming from a Higgs boson. And we had on 4th of July a historical day. You see, these are the two spokes of the two experiments at the, from CMS and from ATLAS. At that time it was Fabiola. This is Peter Higgs talking to François Englert from Belgium. And they both published, together with Monsieur Braut, who unfortunately passed away already, they both published different papers in the year 1964. So they published 1964, and the first time they ever met was on the 4th of July 2012. So we had to have this discovery so that these guys could meet. Okay? So, and this is in large, in the photon-photon reconstruction, that's the mass of the two photons, you see it peaks here at 125. This is the background from the standard model. So the snow field, the snow storm, and this is the special snowflake accumulating at one point, at one mass point. And this is here in the two photon case. So that was the signal from CMS. And it's interesting to see the evolution of this axis over 1 year, over 12 months. Now I take the ATLAS one, and I like this more than the increasing statistics. Okay, this is the compatibility with what you see with background, so, or the incompatibility with the background. So if it's background, then it should just fluctuate around with little statistics. The more statistics you have, the closer it should come to one. And it should stay at one. It should be rather a straight line if you have infinite statistics and essentially no measurement error. But here you have not very much statistics. You see it fluctuates around, and that was July 2011, and the largest fluctuation was here, around 130 GeV. Then came December 2011, and you see with more statistics it's essentially flat everywhere, so it's background, compatible with the background, and here you have a signal coming out with 3 sigma or 3.5 sigma. So at that time it was called evidence. But here I have to insert a short story. July 2011, that was at the conference in Grenoble, we had a press conference here with, yeah, obviously with media. And then one journalist said, why don't you present the result yet? You measure since 2 years, you don't have a result yet. And so I looked at him and told him, we need more statistics. You have to be patient. It takes time. And then he said, but we journalists are not patient. Then I looked at him again and said, but you can learn it. And then afterwards he came to me and asked if he can make a story out of it. I said, yes, it was a nice short story. And then in December, a journalist came to me and said, do you remember me? I said, yeah, vaguely. And he said, I'm the one with the patience. And I have learned it. So we can even educate journalists. Okay. So that was December 2011. Then with adding more data, you see it's still flat everywhere. The signal went a bit smaller, but that's normal. One also has to be used to the fact that signal strengths can vary. And then July 2012, you see everywhere flat, and now you have a 5 sigma evident, 5 sigma discovery of this particle. But isn't that, and then when they published, it went even to 6 sigma. But isn't that nice? Isn't that a textbook plot? How such a signal with increasing statistics really emerges over time. I find this amazing, fantastic. So, and both experiments have now in individual channels more than 6 sigma, so it's all clear. So we had a remarkable year 2012. And this is the physics letters issue with the CMS and the ATLAS result. But the year 2012 was also remarkable in the sense that it was not only a particle physics result here, but that it caught the attention of everybody. And I like this one from The Economist very much because it says it's a giant leap for science. And I think this is very important to point out that we are all working for science. Okay, we are doing particle physics, but we are working for science and for the attention in the general public for science. And actually, the editorial is very well written here in that issue of The Economist. So, a giant leap for science, and this is what is important, that people learn about science more and more. So, March 2013, so that's 2 months ago. No, 1 month ago. 1 month ago, okay. We could state we have a Higgs boson. Because at the time of the July seminar, we said a Higgs-like. Now, in March 2013, we were able to drop the like, despite the fact that we like Higgs. Why do we have a Higgs boson now? Because its properties, its quantum numbers, its spin, and its couplings to the other bosonic particles are, as you expect, from a particle which is the messenger of the mass-giving mechanism. So it has the properties of a Higgs boson. However, we cannot rule out a beyond the standard model Higgs boson. We cannot state it is the Higgs boson of the standard model, but it is a Higgs boson. Because any model beyond the standard model would require more Higgs bosons. And what do we have to do now? Well, it's only the beginning, as I said. But now we can state it is a Higgs boson. But is it the Higgs of the standard model or one of several? And therefore, we have to measure its properties. And by measuring its properties, it could give information on dark matter. Because if one of the properties, for example, deviates from the standard model prediction, that could be an indication for dark matter particles. Its properties could give maybe first hints on the behavior of dark energy. So with this one single particle, which explains our existence to some extent, we can now hope that we can really study also dark matter and maybe even dark energy. And the LHC will address these questions and many, many more. And therefore, we have a physics program at the LHC beyond 2030. So for roughly 20 years, we will use the machine and the experiments. And that's another dream of mine. Our understanding of the universe, I guess, is about to change with this particle in hand and with the new measurements. So, the past decades, and it took us 50 years to describe 5% of our universe, that's a discovery of the standard model. The LHC delivers data. We have already a discovery in our hands after the first 3 years. I think we are just now at the beginning of exploring 95% of the universe, and I think it's high time to explore 95% of the universe. So, I think the future is bright in the dark universe. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Can we have some light in this dark universe as well, please? Because Professor Hoyer has kindly agreed to take some questions arising from his fascinating lecture. So are there questions for Professor Hoyer?
No, the program until 2030 or slightly beyond is only with a proton-proton collider. And one of the key issues is to measure the properties of the Higgs, for example, very, very precisely. In particular, this Higgs boson can couple to itself. And to measure this self-coupling needs a tremendous amount of collisions. And therefore, we need quite a few years in order to measure this, at least to some accuracy. But then, of course, there are other processes which we are hoping to measure. But if you only concentrate on the Higgs, this is one of the key issues. We are not creating it, that's up to somebody else. We are producing it. But there are no ethical considerations. I mean, the Higgs, a priori, it's a particle like others which you produce. However, its special properties make it a special particle. But there are no ethical considerations. These experiments address fundamental questions which, in principle, you are always also asking yourself, maybe not every day, but don't you from time to time think about how did everything begin? How did everything develop? These are the basic questions which one is interested in, how the universe started after the Big Bang and how everything fits together. And therefore, this captures already the imagination. Then the second one is that this is a huge experiment which is done. You could call it a world machine because the world is using this machine because we have 98 nationalities registered to work at CERN, 98. So all these people are working on one question, namely to understand the microcosm and to understand the early universe. The other one is, and that you can do that, that mankind can do that, is also already fascinating. So all these things together, I think, make it a very interesting and very fascinating project. Then, of course, you have to, from time to time, to give some press releases and such things. But you can only do that once you have good results. And we were, fortunate, I think that's the right word, we were fortunate that we found the Higgs particle after 3 years of running, or 2.5 years of running. Because originally, the first studies showed that you need several years at the full energy in order to find the first glimpse of this particle. Everybody thought, the first thing you will find is supersymmetry because it's easy, has rather high production rate. No. In 2010, we realized that the machine was running better than expected. The experiments were working better than I expected. The grid computing worked better than I expected. And then we suddenly saw if we extend the run up to the end of 2012, because originally we were already in a shutdown in 2012. That was the plan. But then we realized if we run until the end of 2012, we could find it. And in 2011, I did something which no director general ever should do. I promised a discovery. However, I did it in the following way. I told the funding agencies, we will have a discovery. We will either find or exclude the existence of that particle. Both would have been a discovery. Now, fortunately, we found it. Okay. I don't know, because up to now they are not tired. It is for me, it's also fascinating to see how interested the people are. Yeah? And usually, when you have a science result, it is like a delta function. So no interest before, huge interest, and then no interest anymore. Since the announcement of the discovery in July 2012, I still have interviews roughly on the average one per week. So that means there's really a more or less sustainable long-term tail in the interest by the, from the media. And the media would not be interested if the readers would not be interested. So there is still a lot of interest, and we are trying to satisfy it also by using as far as we can examples and to show people things, etc. So, for example, in the last weekend of September this year, we have open doors, Saturday and Sunday, because one can go down at the moment, but only on pre-registration, because otherwise we cannot handle the stream of people. It's fascinating how interested the people are. And we try to do our best to explain as much as we can. That's all I can say. Well, these four big experiments, they address many, many different questions at the same time in the same amount of data. So in the same amount of data where you find the Higgs particle, for example, you also find information about the strong force where the gluon is the mediator of that. In the heavy ion collisions, one of the main topics there is to understand better the strong force, the behavior of the strong force at this energy. So in parallel, these things are going on all the time, also with the study of the Higgs, etc. So if you read the scientific literature, you will find quite a few articles also about strong force, the behavior of strong force, etc. But this is, of course, not as sexy as the discovery of a Higgs boson. But it's going on, huh? No, for you it is. Okay, yeah, sorry. One always has at least one person where one makes a diplomatic mistake. Yes, okay. No problem. Okay. No, it is for the general public, I meant, of course. So it's all going on at the same time because all people are looking at the same amount of data, just selecting different topics out of it.
So, Ralph, thank you very much for this evening's lecture. Thank you for coming back to the university. And thank you to you and to your colleagues for the contribution that you've made to quite profound understanding. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Ralph Dieterhoy. Thanks very much. Thank you.